أعوذ بالله السميع العليم من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهدي الله فهو المهتد ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله أيتها الأخوات أيها الإخوة أحييكم بتحية الإسلام تحية من عند الله مباركة طيبة السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Thank you so much for your invitation this evening and for you who are here sitting with us while you welcomed my father a long time ago, rahimahullah, when he came in this country. This is my first visit to Sri Lanka, hopefully not the last one, inshallah. It depends on you, depending on your reaction to what you are going to hear. So thank you so much for that, and I'm very happy to see so many people this evening. Let me start with an introduction. While we are now experiencing a very special time, it's the 10th of Dhul Hijjah. And when we speak about the Prophet, it's always very important to reconnect his story, who he was, coming with the final message in Islam to the one who was sammakum al-Muslimin, who is the father of the monotheistic traditions, Ibrahim alayhi salam. And of course, Eid al-Adha is directly connected to this story. And when I was writing the Sirah, the book on the book which was called, in fact, In the Footsteps of the Prophet, peace be upon him, I started with this connection between Ibrahim alayhi salam and the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi salam. Why? Because there is something which is very special in when you come back to Ibrahim. This is where we understand that we are following ourselves. It has to be louder.
I'll get it adjusted.
They will adjust it? Okay. What I was saying is that we understand through the figure of Ibrahim alayhi salam that we are ourselves not only following in the footsteps of the Prophet, but we are following a tradition, a monotheistic tradition, which makes our message a universal message. We acknowledge the fact that Isa alayhi salam was a messenger. We acknowledge the fact that Musa alayhi salam was a messenger, and all the other prophets and messengers that were before. And the one who is central in our tradition, he's central, but it's not exclusively central, because we go back to Adam alayhi salam, which is very important for us. There is a history, which is a sacred history of messages. We come back to Ibrahim alayhi salam. And this is where we find something which is quite interesting. When you read the Bible, you see same stories. Sometimes it's almost the same, with two or three details or apparent details that we can see. So the story that we have in the Bible is not exactly the same story that we have in Al-Quran Al-Karim. And often what we say as Muslims, you know what is the difference? The difference is that for the Muslim it is Ismail, and for the in the Bible it's Ishaq. That's not the main difference. Of course, it's important because the filiation out of this, it's important. But when we come to the Quran, the story itself, it's different. And why is it different? It's that in the Bible, when he's going to sacrifice his son, he's not telling him, I'm going to sacrifice you. He say, God will know. He keeps silent. In the Quran, it's not at all the same. And this is very essential. Why? Because he's asking to ask his son. فَلَمَّا بَلَغَ مَعَهُ السَّعِ قَالَ يَا بُنَيَّ إِنِّي أَرَى فِي الْمَنَامِ أَنِّي أُذْبِحُكَ فَانْظُرْ مَاذَا تَرَى قال يا أبتي افعل ما تؤمر ستجدني إن شاء الله من الصابرين. So he's saying, oh my son, I saw in my dream that I'm going to slaughter you. So what do you, how do you see? He's asking his son. أني أذبحك, I'm going to slaughter you, and this is what I have to do. This is the order coming from God. And the son is responding as a believer, because Ismail is a believer. He say, Ya Abati, if'al ma tu'mar, do what you are commanded to do, satajiduni insha'Allah min as-sabirin, you will find me from those who are patient, accepting the will of God. If you look at the story, it was a long time. Ibrahim alayhi salam was waiting a long time to get a child, and it was impossible for him. When he was old, he got the child. And Allah is asking him, now you have to sacrifice your child. Meaning what? The first level of the story is one love against the other. It's show me how much you love me, and if you love me more than your son. That's the first level. This is what we have when we come to the Bible, and this is why we agree on this, that this was very difficult. I have to sacrifice the son that I love for God, that I have to show my love more. But his son is also loving God. Ya abati if'al ma tu'mar. My father, do what you are commanded. So I'm ready to give my life out of my love to him and to be sacrificed. And then the story goes that it's exactly the same, that he will be saved. The point here is exactly this discussion. In fact, it's not love against love. And by the way, it was in هَذَا هُوَ الْبَلَاءُ الْمُبِينُ. This is what you find in the Quran. This is the great trial. The trial is, choose between me and your son. In between, there is something which is essential in the Islamic tradition that you will find in every step of the Prophet's life. That when you are tried, when you are to go through suffering, Allah is not going to let you alone. All the stories that we had from the theological viewpoint in Christianity, we don't find this very specific dimension of you being alone in front of God. So you have to face it alone. Allah is putting you in a test, he's testing you, but he's always sending signs for you to see. And the sign here was his son. He was not alone responding to the call of God. His son told him, do it. Putting his father in a situation where, I'm alone, I have to do this, do it. So appeasing the father through the son, sending a sign to the trial, which is completely opposite to the Bible and what, for example, in the Western tradition, philosopher like Kierkegaard was saying, what is tragic in faith is you are alone facing God and sometimes you don't understand. That's not what is in the Quran. It's not in the Quran. It's not beyond your understanding, and you always have signs and people and something is going to help you. You are never alone. If you look at the sign, if you listen at what is said, if you see around you, and for every one of us now, you can go through suffering, you can go through trials, you can go through loneliness, but at one point, come back to God, and you will see what he is saying in the Quran, سَنُرِيهِمْ آيَاتِنَا فِي الْآفَاقِ وَفِي أَنفُسِهِمْ. We are going to show them our signs in the horizons and in themselves. If only you see the sign. So Allah put Ibrahim in this trial. And at the end of the story, وَتَرَقْنَا عَلَيْهِ فِي الْآخِرِينَ, meaning through this story that was a triumph for him, this is where you today and all the human history is praising Abraham as a great prophet because he went through this and he was faithful to the word of God. So a trial in your life could be praising you in history. Not only this, at the end of the story, look at this. Salamun ala Ibrahim. Peace be upon Ibrahim. So the word peace, it's important because when you come to the prophet's life, everything has to do with peace. And us as Muslims, al-Islam wa salam are the central teaching of our religion. And you'll see why. Now, this is the story that is where we, in a few days, we'll have the Eid and Eid al-Adha and slaughtering and all this. This is what we should remember. This is the story. The story of somebody who was faithful to his word and went to the point that he was ready to sacrifice his son. And then he was saved and became the closer one to the Allah, to the one, to the only God. Now, what we understand through this story, it's not love against love. You know the other verse that you are always referring to? Allahu nuru samawati wal ard. God is the light of the earth and the heaven. And you say, light, it's nurun ala nur, light upon light. The story of Ibrahim is love upon love. It's not love against love. So I love you. We both love God. In the name of our love of God, we are going to do it. You, out of your love, you are asking me to do what Allah is asking me. So it's something which is deep and cannot be experienced only if you have faith. So love upon love, ending with salam. Now come to something else which we do during the last 10 nights of Ramadan. Now we are talking about the last 10 days. And you have the last 10 nights. And then you come to one surah in the Quran, which is, Inna anzalnahu fi laylat al-qadr. What is the last verse of this? Salamun hiya hatta matla' al-fajr. Salam. This night is a night of peace. As if, when you come to the Quran, you come to Ibrahim alayhi salam, and you come to everything that came from our religion, in the word Islam, you have salam, which is peace, and this is what you have to get. And in the stories, what you understand, to all the trials, what you need to reach is salam, it's peace. And all what we are going to see through the prophet's life, alayhi salam, is he was a prophet who said to all the people around him, to all the Muslims, Ifshu salam, spread peace around you. But to spread peace around you, it's not just to come and to say, as we had in the 60s around the world, peace and love. That's not enough. It's very, very demanding. To be an agent of peace today, it's very demanding. Because you have to look at your own self. What in yourself is not helping you to get that inner peace? It starts within. What in your relationship with the universe is not putting you at peace? What in the relationships with animals is not putting you at peace? What in the relationship you have with your fellow human beings who are not following Islam or are people of other faith, how are you going to be at peace with them? If you are serious about peace, you should be serious about your own spiritual, intellectual, cultural, social, political, economic education. That's a long process. But this is the way. This is the path. And then what we had in the verse that was read, شَرَعَ لَكُمْ مِنَ الدِّينِ مَا وَصَّى بِهِ نُوحًا. So it's coming from before. And this is also what we have to understand, that it's a path. And it comes from all the messengers, and it went through all the messengers, and now we have to follow in the footsteps of our prophet, Muhammad, alayhi wasalam. Having said that, and this is something which is important in our discussion, it's to understand in which way we have to understand this relationship. Now, the point that I wanted to add to this is when we look at his life, as you know, very often we speak about al-Ahd al-Makki wal-Madani, it's the Meccan period, the Medinian period, and Orientalists are saying he was peaceful during the first period, he was involved in wars during the second period. I'm not going to follow this, and I'm not going to follow as well what you have as the traditional sirah or biography that we have. We have 45 minutes altogether. It's you can't go through all the details. What I'm going to do is just to highlight some of the things that every one of us today should think about to make his life relevant for our life today. So that's my task. In which way his life is talking to you today? In which way his life is a mirror for your life today? Because this is what we have in the Quran. لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ. You have the best example with the Prophet, السلام. So in which way this is coming back to you? So how do you extract, do you draw from this life teachings that are important for you today? So what is important here is to ask ourselves, before even he got the first revelation, he was Muhammad ibn Abdullah. He was not Rasulullah. Before he was Rasulullah. There are things that are very important that we need to remember. In which way, what came after with the revelation when he was 40 was confirming what he had before. Why is it important? Because very often, you are a minority in Sri Lanka, Muslims. And by the way, you are not only Muslims in this room. But the Muslims are a minority. What is important is not to think that you have a closed universe of reference, not connected to what came before and what other people have. Because the Prophet, before he got the revelation, he had some qualities that came to be confirmed afterward by the revelation. So he had, with his humanity, values that the revelation came to confirm. And this is why he himself, talking about his mission, he said, إِنَّمَا بُعِثْتُ لِأُتَمِّمَ مَكَارِمَ الْأَخْلَاقِ. I came to complete the good character, meaning something was before me. And where was this? It was in the Christian tradition, in the Jewish tradition, but not only in culture, even in the Arab culture. Why the people, when they saw the Prophet, before he was the Prophet, were talking about him by saying, you are a Sadiqul Amin, the truthful and the trustworthy. Why? Because they saw in him, when he speak the truth. And when he says something, he do it. He does it. When he say that he's going to do something, when he has a trust, he keep it. When he give a word, he is faithful to his word. So this is something which has to do with universal values. إِنَّكَ لَعَلَى خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ. You are indeed a person with good manners, good behavior, good values. So al-akhlaq came before even the principles of faith, al-aqidah, and then the five pillars of Islam, as-salah, was-zakah, all this. They came to confirm this. They came to say what you had before was right, and what you have to keep is what was right in who you were before. Which is very important for some of the people who come to Islam. Our message to them is you have to change everything. But that's not true. Everything which was good before, keep it. You only have to change what was wrong. But what was good, keep it. So you should not disconnect from your past. You should build on your past. Because your past is your school. Your past is your destiny. And Allah, Azza wa Jal, never teach you, never bring you to, brings you into something which is your past with no reason. There is no something which is coming by accident. There are always reasons to what you're experiencing. Maybe you don't know them. Maybe you see things in a negative way. عَسَىٰ أَن تَقْرَأُوا شَيْئًا وَهُوَ خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ. It might be that you see things in a very negative way, and this is good for you. It's negative at the moment you experience it, but it's going to be good on the long term. It's changing you. So when you come to the first part of his life before, you can see that the way he was very important in the way he was dealing with human beings. First, he never brought all the what they were worshipping, the idols and all this. What we had coming from the tradition is that he didn't like that. He was not at peace with that. There was something that was troubling him. Even, you know, the Prophet, even the way he talk about sins is always about not being at peace. مَا حَاكَ فِي نَفْسِكَ وَكَرِهْتَ أَن يَطَّلِعَ عَلَيْهِ النَّاسِ. What is in your sight? What is sin? What is sin is what is in your heart is troubling your heart, and you don't want the people to know about it. Which is, you are not at peace. Because you know that's not right. And every single human being in this room knows exactly what I'm talking about. Don't you? You know that this is something. So this is the spiritual side, that everything in our religion comes to this. Get that inner peace. This is where you have to start. So he came before with this, which has to do with how are you going to be at peace with yourself when you are consistent between your values and what you do. And this is why later in the Quran, الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ, those who believe and do good deeds. So there is consistency. There is consistency, so there is peace. And the Prophet ﷺ came with this. Before even getting the message, he was not happy with what they were worshipping. He was quite isolated. But the way he was behaving with them was out of good manner, good behavior, al-akhlaq. And this is why we have them in the Quran. وَإِنَّكَ لَعَلَى خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ. So this is also something which is important for a second reason. Is the Prophet ﷺ, before starting talking about faith that is coming from within, was visible before he was the messenger from outside, not because he was powerful, not because he was wealthy, not because he had money, but he has this ethical distinction. The people, they knew that he had a word, and then he was also trustworthy. This is very important because all our religion, and if you in Sri Lanka should get something out of this teaching, is to remember which type of visibility you have in Sri Lanka with your fellow brothers and sisters in humanity. And I'm saying it on purpose. يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسِ إِنَّ خَلَقْنَاكُمْ مِنْ ذَكَرٍ وَأُنْثَى. O you people, we created you from a man and a woman, from a male and a female, meaning you have the same origin. Willing it or not, you are brothers and sisters in humanity. And this is not a new interpretation of the verse. It's something which is very old in our tradition, that we need to look at the people with this. We have common values and we have common origin. And we have common value because we have a common origin. And we have a common origin because Allah put from the beginning us this light, this fitra, this spark that we have to come back. So this is why we are not scared of people not being Muslims talking about values that we acknowledge. They are the same. We don't have a problem with this. So we should be confident with our values in order to be open with the values of our brothers and sisters in humanity. And we have brothers and sisters in humanity. This is what was coming from the 14th century, 15th century, even with Imam al-Nawawi, that you are reading some of the ahadith speaking about لا يؤمن أحدكم حتى يحب لأخي ما يحبه لنفسه, meaning you are not completing your faith if you don't like for your brother what you like for yourself, meaning your brother in humanity. I want for you the best. So this is the Prophet ﷺ that was coming before he got the revelation, and he was in himself trying to have this peace inside. He was looking for peace inside. In some of the stories that you know, when they were building Al-Kaaba, and they were not knowing, you know, the powerful were struggling, they were said, the first one who will come, we will ask him to help us to find a solution. What did he find a solution? You know the solution, but what was very important, it was he was an agent of peace. He tried to, he listened to everything that they had to say, and it has to do with power. Who will have the privilege to put the black stone? So he found the solution, which was making peace between them and not nurturing the power struggle within which they were. Once again, before he got the revelation, this is the man who was getting inner peace by doing what he was, the values that he was following and that he was supporting, and at the same time with the people trying to find peace and to promote peace. Not only this, when he was 12, and that was before, he was, and you know, you heard about Hilf al-Fudul, when he was there, and this is, according to the tradition, this is the first time he met Ibrahim, alayhi radiallahu anhu. So, Abu Bakr al-Siddiq, radiallahu anhu. So he met him there. It was said that this is the first time they met. We are not sure about this, but the point is that when they were in Abdullah ibn Jud'an, and they took the pact that anyone who is going to be mistreated, even if he does not have the support of a clan, of a tribe, we should support him in the name of justice, not in the name of the alliances that he had. And the Prophet ﷺ later would say, if I was to come back to this, I would come back to it with Islam. Meaning what? The principle of justice before Islam is confirmed by Islam, in the name of Islam and in the name of our tradition. Meaning some values are beyond the message, and the message is confirming these values. Justice is justice. There is not something that could be called Islamic justice for Muslims as opposed to justice for others. We have principles of justice that should be the same. And this one is very important, that you cannot discriminate because of your belonging to the powerful versus the weak people. So that's very important, because this came from the very beginning as something that we have to learn. Why am I saying this, and why I'm insisting on some of the features and some of the stories that we have before the revelation? And why I'm also starting with Ibrahim alayhi salam? Because Ibrahim alayhi salam coming before, and then the whole history, and now before he started with the revelation, this is showing us how much, when we are in the footsteps of the Prophet ﷺ, we need to get the universal dimension of the message. The universal dimension of the message means that we are here talking about ethical behavior. We are talking about love, as we had in the story of Ibrahim alayhi salam. We are talking about justice. We are talking about peace. We are talking about serving the people. This was before he got the message. And who was his educator? Allah Azza wa Jal was educating him to be able then to come with what? The rules and the way. The rules and the way. But before the rules and the way, the universal dimension of the message is understood as وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. You have been sent as a mercy for the worlds, meaning the visible and the invisible, the world of human beings, but also animals, nature, everything. You are a rahmah. So we are following a messenger. We are following the Prophet ﷺ, who was sent as a mercy. And if you are true followers, wherever you are, you have to ask yourself, am I a mercy for the people around me? That's as simple as that. And if now they say, you know what, at the end of the day in Sri Lanka, they look at us as problems, You're not going, you can't all your life say to blame them to see you as a problem. Because if you, they see you as a problem, there is a problem. There is a problem. In the way you understand your religion, in the way you are experiencing your religion, in the way you are serving people, in the way you are active in the society. Of course, there are powers and there are media and there are people who are trying to distort the message. That's fine. But the problem is where all when the message is distorted by very powerful people, where are the simple people who are faithful to the message? Where are the mediator in our daily life just to show this, to follow in the footsteps of the Prophet ﷺ? Because you know that during his life, he was called a magician, a liar. He was insulted, and still he was following the path. So this is why we have to ask ourselves. Now we come to the revelation and after the revelation. What was very important is that he was looking for an answer. He was looking for an answer, not happy with what the people were worshipping, idols, polytheism. And he was looking, and during Ramadan, before the Ramadan that we know, he was going to Ghar Hira, to the cave, and trying to get an answer. And then came the answer. And the answer, the essence of the answer he got is three things. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saw that he was not at peace with his own self. And what he gave him, and this is something which is essential from an Islamic perspective, and this is why you should understand, when you come to the Prophet ﷺ, you understand the centrality, the essence, the full dimension of what Tawheed means. La ilaha illallah. All what the people are worshipping, just you have to liberate yourself from that. No peace if you worship something or somebody else. No peace. You came to me seeking peace, here is peace for you. Salamun ala Ibrahim. So he responded to the call. Whatever is the call, whatever is the price, I am more important for your salvation than your son. I am more important for your salvation than your money. I am more important for your salvation than your position, than what the people think of you. I'm the only thing that matters for your salvation. La ilaha illallah. Got that? It's very simple to say, but it's a revolution. Because now you come to you. Is he the most important thing in your life? Are you serious about that? Are we serious? All of us. Why do we have to understand that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying in the Quran, كَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا فِيكُمْ رَسُولًا مِّنْكُمْ يَتْلُوا عَلَيْكُمْ آيَتِنَا. So the message is coming. وَيُزَكِّيكُمْ. The most important thing here is to يُزَكِّيكُمْ. He is purifying yourself. What is this purification? This purification is liberate yourself from all the idols. The visible idols and the invisible idols. الشرك الأكبر, that you think that there is another God, or الشرك الأصغر, you are worshipping in a way or in another, directly or indirectly, money, reputation, look, power. So at one point, the first thing that he was not at peace with this, and he was looking, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told him, peace is through me, with me, and only me. So you have to change the direction. And you know, when you are praying, sometimes you are very technically with your compass and everything, trying to find al-qibla. I mean, حَيْثُ خَرَجْتَ فَوَلِّي وَجْهَكَ شَطْرَ الْمَسْجِدِ الْحَرَامِ, which is, مِنْ حَيْثُ خَرَجْتَ فَوَلِّي وَجْهَكَ شَطْرَ الْمَسْجِدِ الْحَرَامِ, this is the qibla. But that doesn't mean it only that it's the physical way. It's your life. It's you have to direct your life towards him. So while you put your face towards Mecca, you should put your heart at the same time. And as you know, many of us, we have our face in one direction and our heart in another. But it's not visible, except for two, the one and yourself. You know exactly when your face or when your heart is with your face, facing Mecca, facing Al-Kaaba, which is the center. So the first thing that is coming from the first revelation is he was seeking peace. Allah came to him and said, La ilaha illa ana. As he said to Musa alayhi salam, Innani ana Allah, la ilaha illa ana, fa'budni wa aqimi salata li dhikri, that there is no God but me, and then worship me and perform the prayer in order to remember me. So this is one thing. The second thing, which is very important in our tradition and following in the footsteps of the Prophet ﷺ, is you have to acknowledge that he is here, but everything is going to have to do with your education. No way to understand Tawheed if you do not enter into a process of education, of self-education. Education is central. Why? Because this is the spiritual and the intellectual jihad. Be careful. When I'm talking about education, I'm not only talking about intellectual education. Education of the self means educating your heart and educating your mind. اقرأ بسم ربك الذي خلق is two things. اقرأ means read the world, read the book, and change your perception, change your heart. So it's an educational process that is helping you to change. Now, this is the second question. If you are following in the footsteps of the Prophet ﷺ, is not only to read a Surah Nabawiyyah. How much time, how much effort, how much consciousness are you putting to go through this transformational process with your heart and your mind? In fact, it's very simple. How much time are you allocating to your self-education? Education. Not by coming once every 2 months to a lecture and say, oh yes, that's very educational. That's not this. Education is every day. Education is about everything. Everything could be educational. Even people who are far from Islam and not being from your religion are helping you to educate yourself. Everything is about education. It depends how you look at it. It depends how you deal with it. So education is everywhere. This is the second dimension coming from Allah. First was, you want peace? Come to God. Now, you want to keep that peace with God? Educate yourself. Educate yourself means that you have to be in a process which is gaining knowledge. Gaining knowledge. And once again, it's for everybody. No one, we are not expecting you and us to be ulama. Just tomorrow, more knowledgeable than yesterday or today. So you have to be more knowledgeable. And knowledgeable is, for example, how much do you know yourself? How much are you dealing with yourself? And the third thing that is coming from the first revelation, اقرأ بسم ربك الذي خلق, it's اقرأ has to do with the book that is coming, but it's also changing the way you look at nature. And the Prophet ﷺ, in his spiritual journey, he was crying by getting some verses talking not about hell, not talking about paradise, not talking about punishment, but talking about the beauty of nature. And look at this. It's everything. And you know, even when we are talking about wal-fajr, wal-layalin ashr, the 10 nights, it's all about the beauty of nature. Wal-qamar, Shams, everything. And it has to do with a double dimension. I'm always remembering and reminding you with what is coming from Surah Al-Rahman. Shams wal qamar bihusban. It's very precise as the way you see them physically. وَالنَّجْمُ وَالشَّجَرُ يَسْجُدًا. This is spiritual, that you see the tree and you see the star prostrating. You don't see this with your eyes. You see this with your heart. So everything in nature is celebrating the God's presence. سَبَّحَ لِلَّهِ مَا فِي السَّمَوَاتِ وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ. Everything is praising Allah's presence. This is the third dimension coming from the first revelation. He was seeking peace, so peace is with God. Second, through education, and then change the way you look at things. Change the way you look at the world. What I was saying, سَنُرِيهِمْ آيَاتِنَا فِي الْآفَاقِ. So meaning, there are signs around you. Read the world. Read the world. I was just coming today, going to the mosque. We were just facing the sea. And you look at this and say, you know what? Just unbelievable. You just go your face towards Mecca, and then you have the sea. And you look at this and say, Subhanallah. That's the beauty. And then you understand something, which is the beauty outside is mirroring the beauty inside. Why? Because when you acknowledge God, La ilaha illallah, and then you come to him with knowledge and to try to find the signs everywhere. And the more you are knowledgeable, the more you see signs outside that it's coming back to you. Why? Because the beauty of nature is a sign that Allah created. وَمِنْ آيَاتِهِ خَلْقُ السَّمَوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. From his signs, this, the creation of this beauty around you. If you are not with God facing beauty, beauty just becomes something which is normalized in your life. You forget to praise God for the beauty around you when you forget him. When do you where do you have this? When you read the Quran, لا تكونوا كالذين نسوا الله فأنساهم أنفسهم. Don't be like those who are forgetting God. You are going to forget yourself and you forget about the beauty. But it's not only coming from outside. You have in Surah Al-Hujurat something which is confirming what I'm saying. And this is why you are following in the footsteps of the Prophet ﷺ. When you see here, when you see, وَلَكِنَّ اللَّهَ حَبَّبَ إِلَيْكُمُ الْإِيمَانِ وَزَيَّنَهُ فِي قُلُوبِكُمْ. But God had made you love this faith and he beautified it in your heart. So it's beauty. Faith is beauty if you know how to deal with it. So the three things that came from the first revelation was in fact a spiritual, intellectual revolution. It's a revolution, it's a conversion. Ya muqallib al-qulub means he was changing his heart, changing the way he was looking at things. So there is something here which is important for all of us, that the starting point of everything here is I say la ilaha illallah to try to get this inner peace. And I know that I'm not going to get this inner peace if I don't come close to him. And I know that I'm not going to come close to him if I don't get knowledge. Knowledge of myself, knowledge of the world, knowledge of my religion. And I know that I'm not going to go through this process if I'm not able to make peace with the universe. So this is why you understand, you know, all what we have in the Buddhist tradition, the Hindu tradition, the Christian tradition, something which is respect nature, respect animals. And we have to listen to the people who are telling us, be careful Muslims, the way you treat animals when they are alive, and you are only obsessed with the way do you kill them. Bismillah, Allahu Akbar, you kill them in an Islamic way, but you are not protecting them alive in an Islamic way. We have to be very careful with this, because this is coming from our religion. We are following in the footsteps of the Prophet ﷺ. It's all about respecting nature. It's all about celebrating nature. This is the spiritual message of Islam. So this is where, from an Islamic viewpoint, we have to be very deep in this. At the end of the day, what are you doing following the footsteps of the Prophet ﷺ to get this inner peace? With your heart, with your mind, with your surrounding, your environment. That's essential in the way we look at the Prophet ﷺ, and we can see how much himself he was leaving, isolating himself, trying to get this peace and say, I prefer to be on my own to get that peace than to be with people, even if they look at me as a Sadiqul Amin. He left this. There is another story that we have with Abu Hamid al-Ghazali. He left 10 years, the people, because the people were saying, the Sheikh Kibir, Hujjat al-Islam. He left them 10 years. And that's not what I'm seeking. I'm not seeking your praise. I'm thinking my peace. My peace. I need to be at peace with God. La ilaha illallah means I have to come back to my heart. So I better take some. And in fact, why are you praying five times a day? Because al-khushu' that we are talking, al-ladina fi salatim khashi'un, al-khushu' in your prayer, it's exactly this, to come and to isolate yourself from the world to get that peace. This is what is the meaning of praying. Praying has to do with this. So this is where we come to this, with this dimension of this inner peace, this spiritual dimension of Islam, which is so important for us when it comes to the Prophet ﷺ. And understanding the way he was dealing with the world. So the beauty here, it's outside and within. And you also have to remember this, please, Muslims. Why am I insisting on this? Because the starting point of Islam was not for the Prophet ﷺ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't say, this is halal, this is haram, this is... No, this was not. It was converting his... There are things that are halal and things that are haram. No discussion. Because some people, they like this. They like when I'm talking like this. Yes, he's good. Don't be obsessed with al-haram. Talk about duty. Because they don't want to... They are not really serious with al-haram. No. Inna al-halal bayinun, inna al-haram bayinun. We know this. That's al-halal halal, al-haram haram. But we don't start with this. Give me the light, give me the way, and then tell me the limits. Don't start with the limits. This is exactly what Allah did with the Prophet ﷺ. He gave him the light, peace, knowledge, nature. Peace with me, knowledge with yourself and the world, and nature around you. And by nature, everything that is around you. Everything that is around you, you have to look at it. And this is why, even when you see, are you able sometimes to look at people? They're not sharing your faith. They're not Muslims. Or they are not from your tradition. Even among Muslims. Because some are Hanafi or Shafi'i, or majority are Shafi'i here. Some are Hanafi, Brelwi, Tablighi. You know all that, isn't it? Sufi, Salafi. Okay, that's fine. We can look at it as divisions. And by the way, willing it or not, any one of you who thinks that unity is coming out of uniformity, forget about it, you are going to lose. Our unity is not to try to be all agreeing on everything. No, it's just to accept that we have differences and different perspectives. This came from the great scholars, even with the Prophet ﷺ, with the companions. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, radiallahu anhu, didn't have the same opinions as Umar ibn al-Khattab. They didn't have the same temper, not the same understanding, and not the same patience, and not the same involvement. And they were all companions. So now, in your community, you'll deal within your community with people who have different understandings. As long as they are not saying something which is against al-halal or al-haram, or they are not making halal-haram or haram-halal, keep quiet and respect the people. Keep quiet. And sometimes you better keep quiet because you don't even know the answer to the question they are asking. Because some of you are very quick to put people outside Islam. As long as it's not like me, it's nowhere. So this is within. But now, even with people who are Buddhist, Hinduist, some even are atheists, are you able sometime to look at them and to see in them the signs of God's greatness, even though they are acting against it? Are you able to look at people and say, you know what, I don't like what you are doing with yourself. But sometimes I see things in your mind that are just showing me how Allah is great. Meaning, you have to see in the creation signs beyond what the people are doing from them by them about themselves or are doing within their own society. So we have to be able here to differentiate between the two things, which are so important. And this is also something coming from out of our knowledge, our understanding, that sometimes Allah is putting signs of greatness in other people and sign of evil in our community. Also, this is so important when we are dealing with our community. Now, what I wanted to say here is that the first dimension that we got from the Prophet ﷺ is something that you need today. What we call the spiritual dimension, and very often we have it's very difficult. You know, in Islam, spirituality, the word spirituality, rahaniya or rabbaniya, it's very difficult. It could also be connected to tazkiyat al-nafs, which is purification of the self. It's all this that we are talking about. That this is very demanding because it's an effort with our self-education, getting knowledge and being involved in this. But when it comes to this, as Muslims, we see the Prophet ﷺ, and one of the first dimensions that he had from the first revelation had to do with something that we are now neglecting, which has to do with contemplation. Contemplation, what does it mean? Take time to look at yourself, take time to look at the universe, take time. Even when you pray, take time. In fact, you know, while you are fasting, do you think it's only because you prevent yourself from drinking and eating? No. Time is changing when you fast. Take time. That's something which was so important with the Prophet ﷺ. The starting point of revelation is take time. In English, it's take care of yourself. Take care of yourself. So this is the starting point. And it means in our life that we have to come to this. Now, if you look at the second step that is coming out of the Prophet's life, ﷺ, is also the way he was dealing with human beings. And that's very important. He understood from the very moment he got the revelation that in order to get this peace with God, to get knowledge, and to look at the people around, you are an agent of peace by serving the people. And the Prophet ﷺ came with the message, he was serving the people. Rahmatan lil alamin meant serving the people. So this is also something that we have to ask ourselves today. In which way are you serving the people? Serving the people is three levels. The first one, there is something which you should understand. How are you serving the people is to come to how we have to look at ourselves as a spiritual community. وَكَذَلِكَ جَعَلْنَاكُمْ أُمَّةً وَسَطًا لِتَكُونُوا شُهَدَاءَ عَلَى النَّاسِ. We have made you a nation, a community of the middle path in order for you to bear witness to the message of Islam. Serving the people means that the people, when they look at you, they want to understand what is motivating you to behave in such a way. So once again, it comes to the beginning, which is by reforming yourself, you send a message to the people that your presence is an added value in the society. Your witness. And when I meet a Buddhist or a Hinduist or a Christian, the only thing that I'm expecting from them is show me in your behavior the beauty of your faith. And this is what we have to expect from Muslims. Show the people around you how beautiful, how transforming, how revolutionary is your faith. Not by putting, I'm a Muslim, proud to be a Muslim, Islam is the solution. Maybe Islam is the solution, but you are not. Because the way you put it, the way you do it, it's not going to work. So this is where it's very important to understand this dimension, which is serving the people by being an example, being a witness. And especially, you know, very often the Muslims, when they are in minority, they think they have less duty than Muslims in majority country. That's the opposite. I'm sorry to tell you, bad news. Every single Muslim in Sri Lanka, because you are a minority, should be an added value in this society. You should be visible, not out of number, but out of behavior. This is why you are serving the people. And the people look and say, oh, this community, this faith is bringing something to the discussion, is bringing something to the society, it's an added value. So the Prophet ﷺ, in the way he was serving, was this thing. The second one, which is very important here, is serving by showing solidarity. All the prophets, they were first followed by the poor people. By the poor people. And what is important is to know here that it happened with Jesus, alayhi salam, with Moses. All the prophets were followed by the poor people. And the Prophet alayhi salam was followed. And in the Quran, even in the Wal-Fajr, كَلَّا بَلَّا تُكْرِمُونَ الْيَتِيمِ And this is something which is important. Why are you wrong in your behavior? Is that you don't look at the poor people within the society. So there is something here which is important. Serving is also serving the weak among you. Why around the mosque of the Prophet ﷺ, where men and women were working, and one day in Sri Lanka you will have to discuss this, you will have to talk about this. That at one point in the future we need also to think about having our sisters praying in mosques. That's something that we have everywhere in the world now, and we have to be clear with the rules, but we are following in the footsteps of the Prophet ﷺ. And the Prophet ﷺ was clear on the fact that there should be a space. Why is it that in his mosque there is a space for women? And not now in many of our countries. There is a problem here. But the point is not this one. My point, yes, it's a very important point, by the way. But my point is here also to come to an understanding that he was serving the poor. He was, and especially during these days and during Ramadan and during our year, it's very important for us to come to this understanding that we have to serve. How do you serve the people? Muslims and people of other faiths, not only Muslims. So you show solidarity, you serve the people. So you serve through your presence, you serve through your solidarity, and there is another way to serve the people. And this is where it's connecting this kindness towards the people with something which is an other quality that the Prophet ﷺ had. Are you going to serve the people? You know how the people are. We like to follow a majority, and sometimes we are scared of speaking the truth. This is why the Prophet ﷺ said, "Afdalul jihad kalimatu haqqin amam sultanin ja'ir." The best jihad is a word of truth in front of a dictator. So how do you serve the people? You serve the people when your faith is making you a courageous human being. So as much as you should be courageous to sacrifice your son for the sake of God, you should be courageous to face the unjust and to stand up for justice and right. Against your own Muslim brothers and sisters, if they are wrong, and supporting justice, whatever it is. In Surah Ahqaf, Zaliman aw Mazluma, it means here you have to support your brother when he is right and when he's wrong. How am I going to support him when he's wrong? By preventing from doing wrong. So I should be active within my community. So sometimes there are things that are done by Muslims that are unacceptable. Stand up and speak out. And there are things that are done by government. Speak out. Be careful. Speak out means with wisdom, but with courage. Because some are playing with words. They say, you know what? I'm very wise. I keep quiet. That's not courage. That's not wisdom. That's to compromise. That's to give up. No, you should never give up. You should never accept injustice. Now you need to find the best way to do it, but you have to do it. You can't avoid doing it. So this is the way you serve humanity. Why? Because you see how the world is. You see today with the power of media now how you can direct a whole population to go to war in Iraq, as it happened in the United States of America. It was a lie. And the people who are following, yes, go and kill. So if you are not courageous enough, in the name of God, in the name of your faith, in the name of humanity, in the name of justice, to say, no, I don't agree, and to face even the majority, there is something wrong in your presence. You are not an added value. You are just following in the footsteps of the majority. And sometimes the majority is wrong. Other people don't think. Now we are emotionally driven. So my last point here, and to end, is this. Kindness and this courage, it's important. So if you look now at all what I'm saying, I was saying about getting this peace. I'm speaking about getting this knowledge. Having this relationship with nature and your environment. This is to follow the Prophet ﷺ. And then this solidarity to show, to serve the people. And we serve the people through being a witness, through solidarity and courage at the same time. This is also what we have to do. And with all this, what we should understand that we should to achieve as Muslims is what the Prophet ﷺ was trying to do. Even when he was launching a jihad, this was not to kill the people. This was resisting to people who wanted to kill him. This is jihad. الَّذِينَ يُقَاتِلُونَكُمْ So though you have to قاتل, so you have to go towards them, or you have to resist in the way they are trying to kill you. So this is where, as Muslims, we need to understand that at the end, the main word, the main notion that we are getting out of the Prophet's life, ﷺ, is this notion of peace. So try to make this peace, try to get this peace between your heart and your mind, between your heart and your body. And remember, وَعْلَمُوا أَنَّ اللَّهَ يَحُولُ بَيْنَ الْمَرْءِ وَقَلْبِهِ Allah works, Allah, the knowledge of God is between you and your own heart. So come back to this. Take care of yourself. Second, be a witness. Be a witness. We want to see in Sri Lanka Muslims moving, Muslims behaving without talking about Islam, but Islam is everywhere. Don't talk about Islam. Stop talking about Islam. Be a Muslim. Be the right person. Be the added value, a witness, serving and helping the people to understand these are the right values. This is courage. This is good kindness. This is solidarity. And then the last thing which is important, never understand that it should not be a visible presence that has to be disturbing the people. Be beautiful. Work with beauty. Face is beautiful. And what you have to express is beautiful. Look at this. وَاصْبِرْ عَلَى مَا يَقُولُونَ وَهْجُرْهُمْ هَجْرًا جَمِيلًا Be patient with what they are saying and take isolate yourself in a beautiful way. Be agent of peace and beauty. The world needs beautiful people. Beautiful people, you know, سِمَاهُمْ فِي وُجُوهِهِمْ مِنْ أَثَرِ السُّجُودِ We see sign of their face in their the sign of their face in their face. Why? Because there is something that is beautiful. So this is also something that you need to think about. In a world of culture and world culture, where is your creativity? The Prophet ﷺ didn't like poetry that was supporting polytheism, but he liked poetry supporting faith. Beauty is part of our religion. We should be beautiful with the right intention, okay? With the right intention, but culturally, artistically, socially, this beauty should come because the Prophet ﷺ had something which was attracting and attractive at the same, attracting the people. And I think that this is something that we need to get in our life. So ask yourself, how much time are you allocating to your self-education to get peace? In which way you are a witness at the end? Where is beauty in your life? Are the people around you and say, they look at you and say, it's right and beautiful. right and beautiful. Right and beautiful, this is the way we say La ilaha illallah, Muhammadun Rasulullah, wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.